Good morning, church. I hope that all of you are doing well. And this morning, I'm very glad to be here with you all. I know that this is a very special service, as we all know that we continue to meet on the online platform. But here is the truth, that the Lord is present everywhere. And this morning, He is also present in our houses. Amen. Yeah, that's the confidence. I don't know how many of you have been struggling or going through a tough time this week, but I want you to understand and realize that as the Lord's presence is here in our midst, I'm sure that He will continue to touch us, He'll continue to heal us, He'll continue to comfort us, that we can go with great joy after the service. And also, I want to thank the church for cooperating with us so far, because I know that with all the things that we are doing now, your support has been great. This morning, I also feel that as church, we are disconnected, though we are connected. And that's what we at church wants to come up with, this initiation where we'll be meeting as small groups in the houses of a few members of the church. So this morning, apart from the individual viewers, individual people will be worshiping the Lord, we'll also be meeting in groups in Mrs. Julie's house, Mr. Pittman's house, Mrs. Poonima's house, Pastor Dominic's house, Mr. Theophilus's house, and Mrs. Padma's house. So I want to extend a warm greetings to all those people who are meeting together with families in these six groups as well. And I hope that you will continue to enjoy the fellowship, the privilege that the Lord has given us. And in the coming days, we also want to see that we'll be able to fellowship with each other in a much better way. So, I believe that even though things were not going on well, the Lord has been good, and I hope that He has been sustaining you. And with that renewed hope, even as we all bring our complete selves into this worship, I pray it's very appropriate that we surrender ourselves to the Lord and ask Him to take us to this service. So, shall we all bow down our heads and invoke the Lord and His blessings in our midst and ask Him to come and take control of our lives. Spirit of God, the Spirit of power, who empowers people, who anoints people, this morning, we want to say that you are welcome here. I pray, Father, that this moment, as we make a deliberate choice to open ourselves completely to you, to surrender ourselves completely to you, I want to thank you for the breath of life that you've given us. And also, I thank you for this privilege that this morning, as people who are filled with life and breath, we can, Lord, lift your name on the highest. I want to thank you, Lord, for this privilege, and especially even as I continue to surrender. Lord, come and take control of our lives. Lord, come and empower us. Lord, come and enable us. And I pray, Father God, that even as we uphold each other and lift our hearts to you, lift our hands to you, lift our lives to you, I pray that this service of Father God will be a channel of blessing for all of us. Lord, even as we continue, we pray that your Holy Spirit will help us through the service, that we might go back, people who are restored, people who are renewed, people who are full of life, and people who are full of your grace and power. that we could, Lord Jesus, bear fruits for your glory. Lord, I want to surrender all things that we'll be doing today, from praising you and worshiping you, to, Lord Jesus, to listening to the scriptures and your words. I pray that this service will be a blessed one for all of us. Take control. To you we surrender. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
This is amazing grace. This destination, where truth and justice shine like the sun. All of his brilliance, the King of glory, the King of all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would save my faith, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I say, oh, all that you've done for me.
This is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb of Slain, worthy is the King.
Worthy is the Lamb.
I'm your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I say, oh, that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You let down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I see. Reckless.
morning, church. This morning, the Bible passage is taken out from the book of Judges, chapter 16, verse 21 to 31. I repeat again, Judges chapter 16, verse 21 to 31. Then the Philistine seized him, gouged out his eyes, and took him down to Gaza. Binding him with bronze shackles, they set him to grinding in the prison. But the hair on his head began to grow again after it had been shaved. Now the rulers of the Philistines assembled to offer a great sacrifice to Dagon their god, and to celebrate, saying, "Our God has delivered Samson our enemy into our hands." When the people saw him, they praised their God, saying, "Our God has delivered our enemy into our hands, the one who laid waste our land and multiplied our slain." When they were in the high spirits, they shouted, "Bring out Samson to entertain us." So they called Samson out of the prison, and he performed for them. When they stood him among the pillars, Samson said to the servant who held his hand, "Put me where I can feel the pillars that support the temple, so that I may lean against them." Now the temple was crowded with men and women. All the rulers of the Philistines were there, and on the roof were about 3,000 men and women watching Samson perform. Then Samson prayed to the Lord, "O sovereign Lord, remember me. O God, please strengthen me just once more, and let me with one blow get revenge on the Philistine for my two eyes." Then Samson reached towards the two central pillars on which the temple stood, pressing himself against them, his right hand on the one hand, or on the one, and his left hand on the other. Samson said, "Let me die with the Philistines." Then he pushed with all his might, and down came the temple on the rulers and all the people in it. Thus he killed many more when he died than while he lived. Then his brothers and his father's whole family went down to get him. They brought him back and buried him between Zorah and Eshtaol in the tomb of Manoah, his father. He had led Israel 20 years. This is the living word of God. May God bless each and every one of us.
We continue with the series on Judges, brave hearts, faithful people of God in difficult times. And this morning we come to another judge, and the last in the series that we'll be doing. So shall we all bow on our heads, look to the Lord in prayer, and ask Him to lead us through this time. Father, I want to thank You for this wonderful time that You've given to us, and even ask, Lord, we come to this time which is very vital to us. I believe, Lord, that this is an opportunity, this is the privilege that You have given to us. And even as we take part in this, I pray, Father God, that You will open up our hearts and minds. It will help us, Lord, give our ears to You. That Your Spirit will open up the Scriptures to us, that we, Father God, will somehow will be inspired by Your word, will be somehow moved by Your word, will be somehow taught by Your word, that Your word, which is a lamp unto our feet, will, Lord Jesus, help us to understand and realize Your sovereign love for us, and Lord will help us to walk in the right path. I pray that this morning, that Your word will continue to impact all our lives. Take control. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You look at Judges, and I told last week we looked that Jephthah was an approved brave heart despite his struggles. And today we're going to come to another one, Samson. So just want to remind us, judge is not a person as we presume today, where he's there with the law and trying to decide things. But judge during those days was someone who was chosen by God to protect, preserve, and deliver the people from the plight that they have been going through. And Israel during those days They had five formidable enemies, and today we are going to deal with one such enemy, Philistines, who inflicted quite a lot of struggle and pain for the Israelites. So by now I'm sure that we all know this rebellion, punishment, deliverance cycle that happens in the book of Judges about 7 times. So reminding us, Israel would rebel against God, and who in turn would punish them for this. And out of desperation, the Israelites would cry out, call out to God, and God would have mercy on those people and appoint judges. And this judge would deliver them. And as a result, Israel would have peace. And the cycle continues as the Israelites forgot the Lord. And what is interesting to note is that then generation after generation, they committed their lives to the evil things, to the sinful things. Generation after generation, they turned their back to the Lord. And generation after generation, they ended up doing more evil. The next generation were never better off than the former ones. So we see that today we come to another judge, Judge Samson. But I've also come across another judge a couple of weeks back, that is Gideon. In Gideon, we see that he went from being fearful to be a person, you know, who's overcome his fear, who's been weak and gone to become strong. But in Samson, we see the otherwise. He is a man who was strong, and from being strong, he dwindled down to become a very weak person. But still, God was so faithful. So today morning, we are going to look at the restored brave heart, Samson, and how God continued to use him for his glory. Samson was the 12th judge of Israel. He was son of Manoah. And we all know about his persistent, faithful wife. The Bible says that the couple prayed for this child, and the Lord had given to them in a very supernatural way. And not only in a supernatural way, Samson was one of the first supernatural hero, a real hero, a mighty man who was empowered by God to do great things. Somewhat like, you know, we see that very unlikely person, but still God empowers and continues to fulfill his promise that he has given for his people. He was very brash, he was reckless, he was indomitable, but still, now we see that he had his own weakness. He was invincible before men. But he had his failures, and God continued to use it. I think so. If we can think about the present days, he is like the Incredible Hulk, who is mighty, who can decimate any power that's coming against him. So even as I continue to meditate on this restored brave heart, Samson, I want to look at a couple of things through this morning's devotion. The first thing I want to look at is the competence of the restored brave heart. And I've chosen verses across chapter 13 and 14. So the extraordinary birth is something that we come across in this judge's life. So we look at Judges chapter 13 verses 2. As you know that, it says, a certain man of Zorah named Manoah from this clan of Danites had wife, was sterile and remained childless. The angel of the Lord appeared to her and said, you are sterile and childless, but you will conceive and will have a son. So that's an extraordinary thing that happens. Very much it resembles what happened to Jesus, but only thing is, in Mary's case, she was virgin, and here this couple are sterile. And the Lord says to her that, you know, you are going to bear a son. In a very supernatural way, we see that not only is birth or supernatural where the angel appears to him and appoints him for the mission that God is going to accomplish to him, but also in a very supernatural way, we see that the parents were instructed, and they tell them that this child should be a Nazarite. Nazarite was a person who was set apart for the Lord. They would not cut their hair. They would not associate with any people easily. And they'll also live a very set apart life, even if not a secluded life. And they would also not take any of the fermented drinks until they accomplish the vow that the Lord has given them. Such was the birth of this person. What a supernatural experience. And I'm sure that all of us would be thrilled if something like that happens. His birth was very extraordinary. And not just his birth, his living was very, very extraordinary. I want to tell you that he is the strongest man in the Bible. There is no one like him. Now, I'm sure that if there's any a symbol of strength, that is Samson. There are a lot of tales that is being told about Samson. In chapter 14 and chapter 15, we see all of this mighty acts that this person does. First, he kills a lion with a bare hand. And then also we see that he is able to catch about 300 foxes and use it to burn down the field that belonged to the Philistines. And not only that, he took the jawbone of the donkey, and with that was able to kill almost about 1,000 Philistines. Philistines were the fiercest enemy of the Israel, not just during the time of Samson, but also during the time of David and subsequent kings. And today, even today, they are the people who are the thorn in the flesh for the Israelites. If you look at this, my dear people, God had instructed Joshua and others that when they enter the land of Canaan, they are supposed to eliminate all those enemies. Then God give them rest. But when people compromise, the compromise led to this difficult situation that these people became a stumbling block for people of God. Today I want to tell you that Samson was able to do all these things because he had a special anointing of the Lord. He was empowered by the Lord. The Lord was always there by his side. And that's why he was able to live this extraordinary life where he is able to defy the regular things that happens. Today I'm sure that we also come across those kind of people. When God has given us that kind of call and anointing, it's very important for us to surrender ourselves to the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord did great things. God's hand was there with Samson, as God's hand is there with many of us today. Are we listening to God? Are we allowing God to work through our life? So if birth was natural and he lived a very extraordinary life, not only was he competent enough, but his life was filled with complications. The complications in the restored Braveheart's life. So I'm going to look at a specific passage from Judges chapter 14, verses 1 onwards, and also chapter 16 here. Even though we see that such a very bright person, anointed person, empowered person, person who experienced God's presence always, we see a tragedy in the life of Samson. That Samson failed to understand what God wanted him to do. Even though God had bestowed all his blessings and strength on him, Samson never utilized that for God's glory. Today, I want to tell that all of us here, especially if you think that we are anointed, if you think that we are powerful, if you are capable, it's because God has given us those things for a specific person, for a specific purpose. What are we going to do with that? Unfortunately, what happened in Samson's life is that his strength became his weakness. That kind of complicated his life. That kind of took him away from the Lord. And I see a couple of complications. The first thing I see is that there were enemies within. We all know that Philistines were the enemies. But more than the Philistines, I believe that the enemies that Samson had were within us. Why am I trying to say that? Because he was set apart for the Lord, for serving the Lord. But I don't think so. Samson served the Lord. And someone said like this, "You are your greatest enemy." And I believe that this is something that troubles all of us. So as a Nazarite, I told that he was set apart, but he began to indulge himself in sinful life. You're selfish, selfish to the core, and he always wanted to take revenge for what was happening in his own life. Come on, look at me. God empowered him to do the ministry of deliverance, that he could set his people free. But what was unfortunately happening is that Samson was using it more for his personal gain, for his personal revenge, for his personal benefit. And what is one beautiful thing about the Lord is that God is capable to use our weaknesses to complete his own purposes. And that's what we see, that Samson was caught up in a sin, and the sin was like cancer. It was slowly eating him. Instead of surrendering himself to God, Samson surrendered himself to sinful life, and he failed within himself. Today I want to tell you, how many of us are caught up with the cravings that we have? You don't have to. You need to let go. The second thing, what I also want to look at in this is, know that he was distracted from outside. We again look with chapter 14 verses 8 onwards, where Samson was attracted. Samson was proud. Samson was arrogant. And Samson, actually, because of what had happened to him, I told you about the foxes, and he catches them and he destroys them. He was willing to take any step so that he could be vindicated. He could be happy. He could take a revenge on people. But that's not God's way. Let's remember ourselves, that God is expecting us to do something. It's just like a story where Jesus said that there are many people who say yes and do not do what the Lord wants. Samson's story is unfortunately caught like this. And also I see addictions in between. One of the greatest problems that we see in the life of Samson was that he was subject to the addictions in his life. We continue to read in chapter 16 verses 3 onwards. We see that Samson was strong, was mighty, was set apart for the Lord. Instead of focusing and fixing his eyes on the Lord, he set his sight apart and he started to look at things that started to please him. The lust of the eyes. He started to look at the women in his life. And he started to go to prostitutes. We look at that in verses 3. And also we continue to look at the passage where we see that he began a relationship with a Philistine woman, an enemy woman, Delilah, and he indulged for the desires of his heart and eyes. What a tragedy. God had called him to be a great, renowned leader, but instead of going and fighting, this man is focused on his own desires and is spending time with few people who God never intended to be part of his life. And unfortunately, what happened, my dear people? Samson failed to understand that. That's not what God had given him vow for. Today, there are many people who take their power for granted. And as a result, what I see is the consequences for the restored brave heart. And I want to look at the passage that we read today, chapter 16, verses 20 onwards. The Bible says, "What you sow, you will reap, and there is no excuse from it." And that's what is happening. What I see, a tragic thing, a mighty person. In fact, the other judges were not strong at all, but they were able to accomplish so much for the Lord. But Samson, despite being anointed right from the birth, despite being one of the strongest person, we see verses 20. It's very sad as we read, it says that the Lord's Spirit had led him. He had lost a fellowship with the Lord. That's what happens when we take our eyes away from Jesus and start looking into our own desires and comforts. The very first thing that happens is that without our knowledge, that our fellowship with the Lord comes to an end. And that is very tragic, my dear people. Today, many of us are also like that. You know, we've lost our fellowship with the Lord. It's very essential for us to come back to the fellowship that the Lord has called us. And not just that spiritual blessing, the greatest blessing he lost, but even physically also he had his problems. He had his failures. The Philistines, in verse 21, we see, they take Samson, they gouge out his eyes, they cast chains to him, and they treat him like a slave, and he is actually grounding the floor that he became a servant for the people. So sad, right? Now just imagine, people would run away from him. People would be scared of him. And now, no, he's become a mocking person. Let's look at verses 25. If you look at verses 25, it's very interesting for us to note that the people, these Philistines, are making fun of Samson. While they were in the high spirits, they shouted, "Bring out Samson to entertain us." So they called Samson out of the prison and he performed for them. This breaks my heart, my dear people. When Samson did not surrender to God, when he lost the track, instead of being a mighty experience, a power, you know, now he's acting upon what people want. People are making him to perform. And what bothers me is that he performs, he acts to the tune. And that's what happens to us when we don't have fellowship with the Lord. Are we still dancing to the tunes of people? God has called you for a purpose. Even if it's difficult, he will give you enough strength to take you through that. The only question is, are you focused? Are you dedicated? Are you willing to surrender yourself to the Lord? And we see that even in the end point, that even when Samson prays to the Lord, I still see a selfish need. God restored him. But Samson still did not understand that he needs to do things for God. Even though he killed more people when he died by his mighty strength when he broke the temple down. What is very sad and tragic is that Samson dies along with them. He is the first judge we see that who dies when fighting this battle. Because the problem that Samson, instead of waiting on the Lord and depending on the Lord for the power, he was dependent on his own physical strength. He prayed, "Lord, strengthen me for one last time that I might take revenge for my eyes." Are we like that? Are we like that? We think that we are invincible, indomitable, all-powerful, that we don't want to listen to anyone in our lives. My dear people, it's time that we make our resolutions this morning. Because God is giving us enough opportunity. Let our life not end up like what happened to Samson. God does not want us to die. But God wants us to live and continue to glorify him to all the things that we'll be doing. What a pity. Samson was strong, became so weak that death was his only option. And even in his death, I see faithfulness of God where he empowers Samson. He anoints Samson. And still, God accomplishes his purpose of decimating the Philistines. My dear people, today morning, I just want to tell you, do we listen to the voice of the Lord? Ecclesiastes says, the words of the wise are like the gods. It's not easy, but still, it's very necessary. Today, many people are thinking that we are self-sufficient. that we can do all things. I want to tell you, our strength is going to fail. And if we don't have the Lord's anointing on our lives, if we don't have the fellowship in our lives, definitely we are going to experience a dry patch in our lives. We are going to experience this desertedness that is going to break us down. Repent and turn to the Lord. When we turn to the Lord, He's faithful. He'll come back to us. He'll empower us. Look at Romans chapter 6, verses 14 onwards. Verse 14 says, "For sin shall not be your master, because you're not under the law, but under the grace." Amen? If you're still struggling with your addictions, with the problems that you have in your life, you might think that God is using you, but that is going to come to an end, my dear people. Let's say, "Lord, I'm weak. I need your anointing and power and strength all the more in my life." Shall we make it a point and say, "Lord, take control of my life"? Romans, same chapter, verse 16 says, "Whether you're a slave to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness." That's a very simple thing. God is expecting simply one thing, that we become obedient to the Lord. We can get results, fruits, for doing things which is not in the way that the Lord wants. But let's not get deceived. God is looking for the obedience. Today, I just want to tell you that let's not follow the example of Samson. Even though he returned to the Lord, but it was too late for him. And for us, God has given this life at large, and He wants us to change it right away. So are we going to repent? Are we going to restore? Today I want to live with two application points this morning with us. For all those people who think that you're strong, only the Lord is our strength. If our strength doesn't come from the Lord, we need to think about that. The first application is repent. I'm reminded of Revelations where we read, the Lord says, "Repent and turn to their first love." Seek your first love. Repentance is trying to set everything aside and putting God back in our lives, in the track that which will lead us to Him. Today I feel that most of us do not turn to the Lord. You're still busy, engrossed, doing things that we want. Yeah, God is gracious, but let's not take that grace for granted. Let's remember that salvation will not depend on our strength. But even if you are weak, God's grace will take us through. So let's repent and think about the ways where we are not giving ourselves to the Lord completely. During this pandemic period, I don't know how many of you have made a use of this time to renew your fellowship with the Lord, or you're discouraged that you've turned back from Him. If you have gone back, your faith is shaky, repent and turn to Him. He's your first love. He's our first love. And when we turn to Him, He's going to accept us. And the second thing, what I want to live is, let's restore our fellowship with the Lord. That's very important. And that's what we learn from Samson's life. Even though he was in a desperate time, when Samson cried out, "Lord, strengthen me for one more time," God did that. How much more when we are still well off, if we can ask the Lord to renew His fellowship with us, that we could be empowered. Shall we ask the Lord to restore us before it's too late? Yes, my dear people, this is God's given opportunity. Let's turn ourselves back to the Lord. So let's stop thinking about ourselves and let's start thinking about what God is wanting us to do. Shall we all bow our heads and ask the Lord to empower us this morning, to enable us this morning, that we will do things that is pleasing to Him and Him alone. There's anyone who's struggling with addictions. There's anyone who's struggling with distractions. I want to tell you, my dear people, the only solution lies when we turn back to the Lord. So shall we ask the Lord to empower us once more, that we could be renewed, that we could once again serve the Lord with all our might. Father, I want to thank you for this wonderful day and the words, Lord, that has come to us. I pray that this morning that you'll break all of us down once again and make us weak, that we be, Lord Jesus, worthy enough to acknowledge you as our strength. And I pray, Lord, with that strength, we'll be able to overcome everything. Lord, I want to pray for the financial shackles. You break it down in the name of Jesus. Lord, I want to pray for, Lord, physical limitations. I break all those things in the name of Jesus. May we find healing. Lord, I want to break, Lord Jesus, for social difficulties that we have. I pray, Lord, that you would empower us, that we, Father God, Jesus, would be a blessing. Lord, I also want to pray, Lord, especially for our spiritual, Lord Jesus, empowerment. I pray that this morning that you would renew each of us, that we live a life and fight a good fight, that with your power we can be victorious. Thank you. Take control of our lives. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Now let's receive the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Thank you, church, for joining us. I hope that you will continue to reflect on your lives. Surrender your weak moments to the Lord, and I'm sure that the Lord will restore you. I thank all the small groups for meeting in the respective places. I hope that you continue to spend time in prayer and fellowship and be a blessing for each other. God bless you all.